Cholesteatoma. Normally, the middle ear cleft is lined by ciliated columnar epithelium in the anterior and inferior part, by the cuboidal epithelium in the middle part, and by the pavement-like epithelium in the attic part. Cholesteatoma is a misnomer. There is neither cholesterol deposition nor is it a tumor. But since the term is widely used, it is not changed. Hence, cholesteatoma is the presence of keratinizing squamous epithelium in the middle ear. The parts of the cholesteatoma include matrix, which is the keratinizing squamous epithelium, which rests on a thin stroma of fibrous tissue, and a central white mass of keratin debris. This is a picture showing the cholesteatoma in the attic region of the middle ear. As you can see over here, this is the bony part. This is the bony part. This is the central white mass that consists of keratin debris. This is the matrix, that is a stratified squamous epithelium, which is resting on a fibrous stroma. In this picture, the red arrow shows a cholesteatoma and the blue arrow shows the erosions of the surrounding bone. Origin of cholesteatoma. There are various theories for the origin of cholesteatoma. The first one is the presence of congenital cell rests. According to this theory, there are embryonic epidermal cell rests in the middle ear cleft of the temporal bone which give rise to cholesteatoma. The next theory is called as the Whitmack's theory. According to this theory, there is invagination of tympanic membrane from the attic or posterior superior parts of pars tensa in the form of retraction pockets. The outer surface of tympanic membrane is lined by stratified squamous epithelium, which after invagination forms the matrix of cholesteatoma and lays down keratin in the pockets. The next theory is Rudy's theory. According to this theory, the basal cells of the germinal layer of skin proliferate under the influence of infection and lay down keratinizing squamous epithelium in the middle ear. The next theory is the epithelial invasion theory, that is Habermann's theory. According to this theory, the epithelium from the meatus or outer drum surface grows into the middle ear through a pre-existing perforation. This happens especially in the case of marginal perforation where the annulus tympanicus has already been destroyed. The next theory is Sage's theory. Over here, there is metaplasia due to repeated infections and the middle ear mucosa transforms into squamous epithelium. The classification of cholesteatoma. Cholesteatoma can be classified into congenital and acquired types. In acquired, it is further divided into primary and secondary acquired. Dealing with the first category, that is congenital cholesteatoma. Over here, the cholesteatoma arises from the embryonic epidermal cell rests that are present in the middle ear cleft or the temporal bone. The important sites for the occurrence of cholesteatoma include middle ear, petrous apex or cerebellopontine angle. It presents as a white mass behind an intact tympanic membrane, or it may also present with spontaneous rupture of tympanic membrane and discharge in the ear, similar to the case of chronic suppurative otitis media. Coming to the next category, that is primary acquired cholesteatoma. This is a type of acquired cholesteatoma wherein there is no history of previous otitis media or pre-existing perforation. The theories for its genesis include: first is the invagination of pars flaccida. This happens due to eustachian tube obstruction that causes persistent negative pressure in the middle ear. Due to this, there is invagination of pars flaccida to create a retraction pocket, which leads to the formation of cholesteatoma due to collection of keratin debris in the retraction pocket. The next theory of its genesis is proliferation of basal cell layer. According to this theory, there is proliferation of the basal layer of pars flaccida induced by subclinical childhood infections. The expanding cholesteatoma then breaks through the pars flaccida, forming an attic perforation. The next theory of genesis is metaplasia of the middle ear mucosa into keratinizing squamous epithelium due to subclinical infections. Next is secondary acquired cholesteatoma, wherein there is a pre-existing perforation in the pars tensa. It is associated with posterior superior marginal perforation or a central large perforation. The theories of genesis in this type of cholesteatoma include migration of squamous epithelium, that is, the keratinizing squamous epithelium of the external auditory canal or outer surface of the tympanic membrane migrates through the perforation into the middle ear. The next theory is metaplasia. due to repeated infections through the perforation, metaplasia of the middle ear mucosa occurs, leading to cholesteatoma. Expansion of cholesteatoma. After entering the middle ear cleft, the cholesteatoma invades the surrounding structures. First, it expands through the surrounding structures that have least resistance, and then there is enzymatic bone destruction. And cholesteatoma, which is in the attic, can expand backwards into the adytus, antrum and mastoid, downwards into the mesotympanum, and medially to surround the incus or the head of malleus. Destruction of the bone. Bone destruction occurs due to various enzymes such as collagenase, acid phosphatase and proteolytic enzymes, which are liberated by osteoclasts and mononuclear inflammatory cells associated with cholesteatoma. There is destruction of the ear ossicles and erosion of bony labyrinth, canal of facial nerve, sinus plate and tegment tympani. The symptoms of cholesteatoma include hearing loss of the affected ear, otorrhea, that is discharge, tinnitus, dizziness, imbalance, fullness of pressure in the ear and facial weakness or paralysis. The complications of cholesteatoma include infection, bone destruction, labyrinthine fistula, intracranial complications, facial nerve paresis or paralysis. The diagnosis of cholesteatoma can be made by a proper history and otologic examination along with tuning fork test, hearing evaluation, tympanometry and CT scan or MRI of the temporal bone. The treatment in cholesteatoma includes, in the initial phases, oral toileting and antibiotic therapy can be given, but later on surgery might be needed. We can do tympanoplasty, that is a surgery used to remove the cholesteatoma from behind the eardrum and repair the eardrum perforation by placing a patch over the hole. We can also do mastoidectomy, that is a surgery to remove the cholesteatoma from the mastoid bone. Tympanomastoidectomy surgery can be done when the cholesteatoma involves both the eardrum or the middle ear space and the mastoid space. We can also do osseculoplasty, that is repair or reconstruction of the three bones of the middle ear, that is the ossicles, that are damaged due to a cholesteatoma. That's it. Thank you.